It takes more than one person to assist in a personal injury claim. I am attorney Glenn Westmoreland, and we have a strong team at the Mack Law Firm. It is our goal to make sure your injury is properly attended to. Contact me at tangilawteam.com and let us get you the help you need.
Okay, before we start, I have a few announcements. The Amy Rotary Club is having their annual catfish dinner on March the 8th from 11 to 1 p.m. And next week, we're going to have a board meeting about our Operation Restore Sidewalks service thing that we're doing, mostly because we want to try and coordinate it with the town's cleanup day in April. So we're going to be having that board meeting next Thursday before our meeting at 11 a.m. Is that a good time for everybody? For our members? We want to try and have it a little bit before our Rotary Club meeting. Also, I would like to announce that Mr. Jerome Rosenblatt is a returning Kentwood Rotarian back there as our guest, so give him a hand. And I'd also like to announce we have another visitor, Mr. Junior Matthew from the Assessor's Office, visiting for the Amy Rotary Club, so give him a hand also. And before we start, we're going to have Hood CEO, Mr. Mike Whittington, come up and give us some updates on the vaccine and COVID-19 and all that.
We finally have moved from the highest incidence rate down to high. So we've actually moved down a notch in Tangipahoa Parish, which is phenomenal. The two surrounding parishes of St. Tammany and Livingston are still having a lot. Region 1, the New Orleans region is still having a lot of cases. That's predominantly where all of the new cases are coming from. Last week, because of the weather, there were very few to no vaccines that shipped out last week. So everyone who was scheduled for vaccines last week got pushed this week, and everyone who was scheduled for this week is kind of being pushed to next week. So that, unfortunately, timing wise for us was terrible, because we had about 800 people that we needed to vaccinate that we had to call and reschedule. So we will continue to do that. We still are getting an ample supply of vaccine, so if you have no people who are looking for that are eligible, who are looking for the vaccine and meet the current criteria, they can call 284-2411 and we can get them scheduled and get them vaccinated as soon as possible. So that's it. The hospitalizations in our area are down, and that's a great thing. So hopefully, just looking at the number of new cases in the state, it looks like about 1/4 to 1/5 of what it was at its peak. So that's great. That's great. So that's it for me. Any questions? Yes, sir.
What is the percentage again? Aren't there percentage levels that they're going by when they start opening up or phasing to going to different?
There are. I don't know the exact triggers for those. I know that we're still looking at about 15% of the people that are tested are positive. So that that's one of the numbers that we look at. How many people, you know, if we test 100 people, about 15 of those are going to be positive. That's been kind of pretty consistent, 15 to 20% throughout this. The number of new cases that will trigger moving to another phase of loosened restrictions, I'm not exactly certain what that is. All right. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, now without further ado, we are going to have our guest speaker, Director of the Tangipahoa Parish Library, Mr. Barry Bradford.
I know y'all want to hear about the new library. I want to start by talking about that. Of course, we have everything in place. The contractor's ready to go. The property is fenced off. However, we have to wait until AT&T takes down the lines that are running across the property. It's apparently against building code to try to begin construction or to build a building if power lines or phone lines or whatever are running across. So that has to come down. Got the pipes underground, so they're going to be laying that new fiber underground either today or early next week, and then they'll be able to bring the phone lines and the phone poles down that are running across the property there. So, and then we can start. Also, it's good news because I think that, you know, we get that fiber optic thing going here. It'll be faster internet speeds for everybody, and that's something that we want to see just happen more and more around here, that we can get better and better internet access, faster speeds and so forth. So it's a long time coming. I know Senator Mizell is working on that, doing her best to try to get better internet access for you guys. So, so we hope to be able to start construction. I would love to start construction next week, if possible. We're ready to go. We've been champing at the bit, and we were hoping to start in December, but we're at the mercy of AT&T on that. So. And thank y'all, any of y'all who called AT&T who are sort of supporting us in that. I appreciate it very much because they are moving towards that goal. But it, you know, with a large company like that, things they have a systematic way of doing things. Sometimes it takes time. So I want to give you a little update on the library in general too, around the system. We are open. I have had people ask me, are we open? Our libraries are open. We're open from 10 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. At the large branches Monday through Saturday. At the smaller branches, we're open 10 to 5:30 Monday through Friday. So we do have some restrictions. We aren't using the meeting rooms. We aren't. Our restrooms are closed for sanitary purposes. But we do allow people to come in. You can browse the shelves. You can use the computers. We'll help you in any way we can, so you are welcome to come into any of the libraries now. I'm hoping that we'll hear good news. Is it today that the governor is going to be speaking? Hopefully we can move to phase three. I know that I keep an eye on the infection rates. Nationally anyway, they seem to be coming down. Death rate seems to be coming down. I'm obviously not an expert, so I'm just telling you what I found on the internet, but I believe that we're seeing a decrease in the number of cases, and I'm hoping that we can then begin to open up more and give people more access. So we are doing some programming. We're not doing programming in-house, really inside. We're doing the outdoor programming. We've done some movie nights. We've done some sidewalk chalk for the kids. We have great grab and go craft packages that you can just drive up. You don't even have to come to the library. We have them outside. You can just grab them, take them home for your kids. We are going on with our African American Heritage celebration is going on this year, and we'll have our award ceremony Saturday. Samuel Eccles is our winner for this year. We're going to be presenting him with the award on Saturday. We're doing some things. We're actually starting a seed library in Hammond. I don't know if you know that libraries across the country they offer a lot of things you can check out. For instance, Chattanooga, I think you can check out power tools and stuff. So there was a time years ago that Chattanooga checked out artwork. You know, they had paintings and various types of artwork that you could check out, you know, and take it home for a certain period of time. So libraries offer a lot of different types of materials you can take out. We were going to offer a seed library in Hammond, which is not really it's the idea is that people can come and get seeds for particular plants and take them home, grow them, and we just ask that you bring back some seeds when you grow your plants, and that way we can keep the seed library kind of in perpetuity, keep it going, keep it moving. So I think that'll be a lot of fun. And we're gonna start that on April 10th. When we get this library open here, we're gonna move it up to the status of a large library. Right now we have three large libraries and three smaller libraries. The larger ones are Amite, Hammond, Ponchatoula. The smaller ones are Kentwood, Independence, and LaRonger. But this new building is going to be actually a little bit larger than Ponchatoula. It's going to be a much larger building. We're going to expand the hours, and it'll have more staff. So there'll be more programming here. We'll have a nice meeting room. You know, we've done things in the past, like we've had Civil War musicians come. I don't know if y'all remember that, but we had Bobby Horton come a couple of times. He specializes in 19th century music, uses 19th century instruments, those kinds of things. So we had Don Knott's daughter come and do a program at Hammond years ago. Those were well attended. We have author events. We'll be doing a lot of that here as well, because we'll have the meeting room space to actually have it. And of course, that meeting room is available for anybody to use free of charge. So it's another good thing about our new library here in Kentwood. So we hope to get that off the ground next week. Oops, I'm sorry. I think I turned on your tablet here. My bad. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about why libraries are important, because I have had a lot of people ask me, you know, why do we need libraries these days? We have the internet, we have Google, and, you know, so, well, there's several reasons why we still need libraries. And one of the main ones is that it's a pillar of the community. By that I mean everything in the library is available to everyone. It's a democratic institution. Anyone can come into our libraries and use the computers, check out books, be part of programs. There is no restriction at all. Anyone can come in, as long as you behave yourself. If somebody creates problems, then we have to put them out, but that's rare. So it is an institution that is foundational to the democracy that we have here in this country, along with a free press and freedom of speech and so forth. So, you know, that's one reason. It gives free internet and free access of all types to everyone regardless. You know, in this day and age, computers are hugely important. It's I think, pretty much impossible to apply for a job these days without doing it online. At least most places require you to fill out an online application. Mm-hmm. And especially during this COVID time, everything seems to be online. So the library has computers available for everyone. They can use those computers for whatever, to apply for social services, to apply for jobs, to find out what jobs are available. Anything you'd like to do that you can do on a computer, you're allowed, as long as it's legal, again. So research medical information. One of the things that people are very interested in, obviously, is coronavirus, but other things as well related to personal medical issues they might have in their own life. You know, they can come and we have books, and we have, obviously, internet access. We have a lot of resources that you can access to get information about different medical issues that you might have, or family members might have, or friends. So that's available. And that leads me to my next point. The information that the library has is vetted. Vetted means it's backed up with scholarship. It's not somebody's opinion out there. Of course, the internet's like the Wild West to me. It's anybody can do pretty much anything out there almost. And, you know, they can put up a site that says, you know, the Holocaust didn't happen. They can put up a site that says, and that's, you know, the nature of the beast. It's open and people can express their opinions. The library provides information that is, as much as we can, guaranteed not to be fake news. It's backed up with a scholarship of professors, people that have devoted their lives to particular career fields. And so, for instance, you want to go online and look at information about coronavirus. We have journals that are electronic journals, also print journals that you can look at that give you the evidence. It's backed up with research. It's backed up by people who know what they're talking about. And so you can count on the information that we have at the library to be as accurate as we can possibly make it. That's important in this day and time when people can say just about anything they want to say without necessarily any proof. So, you know, there are a lot of things. I love Wikipedia, for instance. I don't know if y'all use Wikipedia, but, you know, you just want to find something out real quick, go to Wikipedia, you know, and it's got information there. But you can't use Wikipedia for a research paper because it's built by a lot of different people putting information online. And those people might be professors and scholars, but they also might just be people that, you know, just have an opinion. So you really have to be careful about what you accept as accurate information if you're doing any kind of serious research. And the library provides access to those journals. You could get that information yourself, but it would cost you. And that leads me to my next point, is that the library can save you money. If you use the library, of course the library costs money to run. We do have a millage, it's 5.81 mills that brings in about $3.6 million this year to run the library, to do everything that we do, staff, salaries, everything. You pay that once a year if you're a property owner or a business owner, and we provide that information for you. If you were to go, for instance, to get onto Ancestry, I don't know if y'all are on Ancestry or not. It's a genealogy website. You've probably seen the ads and stuff. Ancestry would cost you, I don't know how much, would it be $100 a year? It used to be about $100 a year. Well, you can access it for nothing with the library. You get a free library card and access it for nothing. Normally, we would only allow, they only allow you to access it from one of our libraries, but right now, you can access Ancestry from home for free if you've got a library card. We got Rosetta Stone, if you want to learn a foreign language. That would cost you if you wanted to sign up as an individual. The library has it again for free. We've got a lot of things that are available. We got free movies, free television, free ebooks. We were talking just a minute ago about ebooks. You know, ebooks would cost you money if you go to Amazon. We have them for free. And if we don't have it, one of the things I would like to encourage you to do is contact me and tell me what you want, because we want to buy what you want to use. You know, I don't want to buy things that nobody's interested in. I want to buy things that you're interested in. So, you know, you can always email me through the website. That goes straight to my email. So I'm happy to answer any questions you might have anytime, you know, that you might have those questions. So you know, all of it, I say it's free. It's not free because we do pay for it with our tax dollars. But you pay your taxes anyway. You might as well take advantage of that. Some of our folks use the library all the time, isn't that right? Yeah, every day almost, huh? And so we're happy that you do. That is why we're here. We're here to provide you with what you need and what you want, and your kids. You know, we do a lot of things for kids. We do lots of programming, for instance. We have three different programs for small kids. We have the Baby and Me program for children as young as 6 months. The parent or caregiver comes and it's called a lap sit program. They almost literally sit in the lap, and we do very simple things with them, you know, finger rhymes, and they learn to bond with the parent or caregiver. They learn to socialize with other kids. They learn gross motor skills. They're introduced to books, a lot of good things just for that early program, Baby and Me. And then we have story time for preschoolers. We have an adventure club for elementary age kids. We have teen programs. We've got something for everybody. We have a lot of adult programs as well. So if you're interested, we do, of course, a summer reading program. It's one of the things that we were talking about earlier is the summer reading program here. Y'all support your library so well. This library is probably the best supported library in terms of numbers of people, percentage of the population that comes and uses it. And that's one reason I wanted y'all to have a new library, because you're committed to it. People actually will turn around and leave because they can't get in the door. So, you know, that's a concern as far as the fire code is concerned, but also it's a concern because we want everybody to be a part of it. And so a bigger building, a nicer, more open area, we'd accommodate more folks. That's one of the reasons we wanted to build here, because I think it will make a big impact and really help this community. We want this new building to help the community commercially as well, to bring some kind of economic help to the community. So, you know, those are the reasons that I've given and give to people all the time. A lot of people have asked me, why are we building the library in Kentwood? Well, it's needed. The library in Kentwood is needed. And y'all have the second smallest building in the system, only 2,400 square feet. The only one smaller is LaRonger, and yet you use it so much. So I'm very happy we can do this. I had the thought right after we built A Meet. My thought was the next library we need to build is here in Kentwood, because I saw the need. That was, gosh, actually probably 2010 when I first started thinking about that. And so now we're, I know it seems like it's never going to get here, but it will. And hopefully in about a year, we're going to have a great grand opening ceremony. We'll have lots of folks here. We'll have food. It'll be a big party, and it'll be an introduction to this new facility that'll be open and free to everybody. Hey, I'm one of them. I like my printed books. I do read a lot of stuff online, but when it comes to my pleasure reading, to reading on my own, I love a printed book. I'm just one of those folks that likes to have it, you know. And I heard a guy say way back in 2009, I think, printed books will be gone in 5 years. Well, they're not. Printed books are here, and they're going to be here with us for a while. I don't know how much longer or whatever, but I love them too. So you're right, we have lots and lots of printed books. My wife and I love printed books, so please come and check them out. If you have a library card, you can go to our website, which is tangilibrary.com, www.tangilibrary.com, and we have all of those services and databases available there. You just click on it, it'll ask you for your library card number, you put it in, and you're on your way. If you want an electronic card, where you just want to access our electronic materials, you can apply for that online. There is an online application form. You fill it out, and we'll mail the card to the address that you asked for. Now, that card won't allow you to check out materials, physical materials, but it'll let you use all of the stuff that we have online, so that's a good question.
Thank you. Get one if you want.
Well, yeah, the better card, because if you get a regular library card, you can access everything and check out physical materials, but you do have to come in. We have to see your ID and so forth because, you know, we are stewards of the taxpayers' dollar, and we want to be able to get the materials back if, you know, if they don't come back on time.
How much stuff do you have checked out that they don't bring it back?
Oh, it's not that bad. Right now, our biggest problem is getting our hotspots, mobile hotspots back, because we do check those out. And so we've had some, we have to turn them off because we can turn them off if they're not brought back. And when we turn them off, people usually bring them back in because, you know, we can't use them anymore. Yes, sir.
With books that are returned, do you have to treat them in a special way?
That's a good question, sir. Thank you. Right now, what we do, when books are returned, we quarantine them for 5 days, meaning we put them aside. We don't touch them. We just leave them for 5 days. Our best information from the CDC is after 5 days, there's nothing that's going to be able to live on the surface of those books that could infect anybody. So, yes, so we everything that comes back, whether it's a book or DVD or whatever, we quarantine for 5 days. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So the meeting room will be open to the public.
Yes.
And what will be the protocol? How will you?
We have a form that you have to fill out. Really, what we have to concern ourselves with the meeting room is that it's not used for making a profit, a company using it to make money, or being used for a political or religious purpose. It needs to be neutral, in other words. We don't take a position on anything in terms of religion or politics. We stay neutral. So we have to make sure that if you know, for instance, you were going to have a debate, that all of those parameters are followed. We also have a rule about food. We can let you bring food in, but we need to know what you're bringing in, if you're going to need to heat up the food or whatever. But almost, I mean, really anybody can use it. And if you do have, we have allowed businesses to come in and do like training, you know, like employee training. That's fine. Yeah.
Before we close out, I just want to mention again about the catfish dinner that they're going to be having at the Amy Rotary Club. If you want to attend, be sure to let our member Evelyn Williams know. She has the list and all the information you'll need to participate in that. So without further ado,
said they will deliver. You don't have to go to any meeting.
No. Okay. I'm going to have them all at City Hall.
Okay.
And then I'll go around and take them to whoever. But I'm asking everyone to please order some because we really try and help out with Amy Rotary the way that they are very supportive to us.
Definitely, yeah. Mr. Rhymes, yes.
When is Senator Mizell going to be here?
Senator Mizell is going to be here next week for our next Rotary Club meeting. So make sure all of you will come out to see that because she'll definitely have some interesting stuff for us. If there isn't anything else, is there anything else? We'll be dismissed with our motto, service above self.
I'm Attorney Pat Dunn. Auto accidents are a part of life. I hope you never need an attorney, but if you do, the team at the Mack Law Firm is here to help. Don't be intimidated by large insurance companies who just want to make your problem go away. We are here to represent your rights and interests. Contact me today at tangilawteam.com and let's get to work.